Welcome back. I'm Alfred Lamont Weber, and today we have an extraordinary guest, two guests, and Patty Greer, who really has brought this show together, will be acting as host. I met not personally, but I was at a free energy conference in Washington, D.C. a number of years ago, and part of the conference dealt with the extraordinary work of our guests today, and so it's a great honor and privilege to be in their presence, and I trust that the audience will join me in welcoming them. And Patty, could you please take over from here?
Well, thank you, Alfred. So what's going on now is we're creating this new movement of bits and parts of how we're going to move into the new paradigm together. Alfred has done this amazing show for decades and developed an audience of tens of thousands of people across the world. The first few shows I did with Alfred, I had more response than any Coast to Coast show, and I've done seven of those, and probably now seven with Alfred with more to come. But his audience are the most intelligent people of any show I've ever done, because they listen, they take it in, and they write letters. You know, I had a lot of interactions in the first bunch of shows, so it really showed me quickly that Alfred has a magical platform and a lot of people that trust him across the world. I have been a filmmaker with no training, never meant to do it, but I've made 8 full feature UFO films in the last 10 years. A couple weeks ago, I just won 2 new Ebie Awards, a couple of these guys behind me, for Best Film and People's Choice for my 8th and perhaps final movie, Crop Circle Diaries. And I have been the most hacked UFO filmmaker in history. So last year was so incredibly, there's not even a word to come up with dealing with little bullies. But it feels like there's little bullies that are just trying to destroy what's really important to get out to the world. What my piece was, I thought it was just the crop circle frequency technologies, which is based in plasma, which is what all these shows are about that we're doing. And all the higher consciousness work is really learning how to work with the plasma field to measure, manipulate, and then spin it correctly so that we can create matter in the way we want it to move. What we're also dealing with, though, is those entities that are reversing the spin of plasma that can destroy matter. And this is a pretty serious time for people like Alfred to get the right shows out there so that we can get all the right technologies in the hands of the most important people. So the one thing that, even though I've been dealing with the lowest of the low in the industry, I've also been dealing with the highest of the high people that are doing the important work. And that's where I started waking up going, okay, they've got Amazon, Vimeo, YouTube, they've got them all just like totally infiltrated. How can we still get out to the people? How can I still serve and bring these unbelievable people to the public? And so I chose Alfred as one of the platforms to bring through what I thought was going to be a TV series of the most remarkable people that have ever played with ETs. You guys are 2 of them. And so in my wonderful surrender at the top of the year, I just decided to work with a couple of major players who have massive show audience. And so last week we introduced Doug Lindman, who did the solar liquid power paint that's going to be infused in roof tiles and you can power the house, infused in paint and you can power the car. These are huge advanced technologies. And today we have the great honor of introducing Ralph and Marsha Ring. And I'm definitely going to let him use the right words to explain how he re-engineered the OTCX1 spacecraft that did function. And it functions so well that the story he's going to tell you will probably curl your toes. So without further ado, I want to introduce Ralph and Marsha.
Thank you, Patty. Thanks very much. I don't really know where to start. I guess a little background would be called for at this point. So, so it'll fill in the dots for people. Basically, I was raised where I'm living now in Paradise, California. I was raised in the woods, and we had a one-room schoolhouse, and my sister and I had to walk 7 miles round trip to go to school. But I graduated eventually from a one-room schoolhouse, and most of my schooling was through an advanced teacher of nature. My teacher would take us out of the classroom into the woods and have us talk to the insects, the birds, the everything. And then as that progressed, she said, now we're going to start talking to trees and rocks. So I didn't think anything different because I was never taught any different. So I became quite comfortable, my sister and I both, with interfacing with nature. And it was quite beautiful. We talked to everything, the fish, and the fish would come almost out of the water when we talked to them. So I found an affinity with nature that was very pleasant and very peaceful until I graduated and had to go out in the big world to find out, well, not everybody had that experience. And the difference was that they seemed to be going in the opposite direction of nature. They seem to have invented or created an idea of their own, and it seemed to repeat itself, going over and over and over. And I follow the beginning and end of many ventures, many tales, many businesses that keep repeating themselves and not really getting any further than that. And to me, the answer was, don't repeat. Intend on doing something and follow the lines and the laws of nature, and you'll find plenty of work to do forever and non-repetitive. It just keeps flowing and flowing, and you can share that out with people, and which what Marcia and I have been doing now for quite a few years, to encourage them to just take the time to look into natural laws, to look into the naturalness of life and the beauty and splendor of just being who you are. You don't even have to try to do anything except be who you are. So that's a summary of the beginning. Let's see. I eventually had to work through I don't want to call it a gauntlet. The passageways of human endeavors, what humans, and I make a distinction here because Marcia and I have found we are pretending to be human. We are thinking we are humans, therefore we create the idea of being human, and so we can live in that metaphor. Or we can progress beyond that, saying, well, this is an experience being human, but that's not who we are. And who we are is much greater than just being human. And so Marcia and I have learned to address people to their higher self or their real self. And a lot of times it's embarrassing for people because they don't know what we're doing. And so we have to kind of find ways to make it comfortable. And then when they are comfortable, we can plant seeds. If they can't see what we're saying right away, someday the seeds will sprout on the difference between a synthetic life and an authentic life. The authentic life is following and being with the laws of nature and developing everything along those lines. Synthetic life is what we made of it, and it doesn't seem to go very far before it has to start over again. So and Marcia, you want to give them a brief idea of who you are? She's my buddy. She's my best friend, by the way. We met 35 years ago in Prescott, Arizona, and she's been my best friend and buddy. And she's gone her way and gotten married. I went my way and got married, and then I had to do it again. And in fact, my first wife, Marcia, was an ordained minister in those days. She still is, but she doesn't need to go there anymore. married my first wife on the grounds where I was building an underground house in Prescott, Arizona. And can you take it from there and say something?
Sure. I feel like I Ralph and I are on the same track in many, many ways. I was born in Lancaster, California, but my father was a fisherman. So we spent most of my younger years fishing out in the open and with the rocks and the trees and everything. So we have a lot in common in that area too. We love the forest, and of course we're living right amongst the animals right now in the tall pines right here in Paradise. It's been an experience living with Ralph and being part of his life. Listening, when I first met him and he would tell his story about the spacecraft, it was pretty well poo-pooed. People didn't really believe him. I tell this story, and it's not what Ralph really wants me to, but I was holding meetings, spiritual meetings in my home when Ralph and his lady were invited to come and speak. And my mom and dad were visiting at that time, and they lived in Barstow, California. And that's about 35 miles from where the craft was teleporting down 10 miles. My mom, after Ralph told his story, said, "Oh, I remember seeing one article in the San Bernardino Sun about the spaceship that moved." So to me, I trusted Ralph anyway, but that made it totally real. And so that's always been kind of a fun thing for me to say, because we really need to go to San Bernardino Sun and find that article, really, but we haven't done it yet. But anyway, that made it truth to me. And at the time that I met Ralph, I knew nothing about free energy. I totally was open to it. I knew a lot about UFOs because I lived in Barstow myself, and saw and experienced some UFOs at that point, but nothing about free energy and what Ralph had done.
Well, so you worked with Bendix.
Yes, I was with Bendix Deep Space Tracking Station for 4 years, and that's outside of Barstow. And I remember one time
you were co-linked with the city of Pasadena, weren't you?
Yes.
PSL?
Yeah. Bendix was an affiliate of JPL in Pasadena.
Jeffrey Felsen Laboratory in Pasadena.
And I remember hearing in an executive meeting that there were lights in the sky, both coming and going, red and blue lights, both coming and going at the same time. And nothing else was said. These were weekly meetings, and nothing was said at the next meetings. And I found the engineer in the hallway one time that had told that story. And I said, "What happened? What was that?" He says, "I don't know what you're talking about." And then the other thing that was a pretty apprise thing, going down to JPL lab and having, this was in 1976, probably to 1980. So it was way back. Going down to JPL and having the person that was giving us a tour tell us that they knew that there was life out in space. They were trying every way they could to actually contact. Music, different kinds of language. They put gold, like a record on the side of the
spaceship.
I can't remember the name of it, but anyway.
Rocket, maybe.
And anyway, it was amazing at that time to have that confirmation when it wasn't out in the news or anything like that.
Well, I think we should tie it in with what Patty's been doing.
Yes.
Oh, God, Patty, you are just an angel on earth to help us all realize and help us reinforce what we have been feeling and knowing and experiencing in our life with your crop circle.
Amazing work.
work. And when she was at JPL, she saw the designs that were going on this gold record, and all of the, it showed the language, it showed the little image of a human, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera.
Music, there were many things.
And they sent it off into space way back 20, 30 years ago. Yeah. And one of your prop circles brought it back. It brought the image, it brought the...
I was so excited when I saw that, yes.
Yeah, because...
Pardon me?
The Jill Bolton crop circle. If we sent it out by telegraph from a SETI satellite. We sent out the code of all these different elements of human languaging on Earth, our DNA structure, And then it came back at the turn of this century in a crop circle.
Yes.
And the only thing that really changed for me was the little guy. It wasn't looking like us. It was looking like...
Big head.
Yeah, big head.
A big head, yeah. Yeah,
it was beautiful, and thank you so much.
Yeah, it was beautiful.
Because that,
well, we've had more than enough evidence that crop circles are real. But again, I think that right now we're in the shift that was, we thought, due for 2012, but it took five more years to, shall we say, remove the cabal piece by piece, chunk by chunk, layer by layer. And we're still cleaning up the mess, draining the swamp, flushing the bog. There's so much work to be done so that what you know, what Alfred knows to be true, what I have discovered by sitting back and just letting it happen, is how the real magic is happening. But the level of hacking I'm dealing with is so insurmountable that all it says to me is, holy crap, I must have some really important stuff here. And the punchline is how real crop circles are. I never went and listened to the other people. I never watched their movies, read their books. So I didn't have all that misinformation loaded in my brain. I went and laid in 100 crop circles. I filmed what I saw and the people that were really there, not the actors. So here I am dealing with some of the worst actors on the planet that are destroying conscious media, destroying all of our UFO events. I mean, so how can I serve? How could I even be this nice? I'm like, anyway, punchline is, I know you guys, I know Alfred, and we're gonna bring it, no matter what it takes, sweat. So please tell us what you invented, reinvented, and how that happened.
Okay, I really can't take the credit for being an inventor as such, a discoverer, yes, because I feel that all things are already there. If we raise our consciousness high enough to realize and accept what's already been done and what's already given to us to foster a greater life, a more expanded, more robust, rich life. And that goes back to Otis Carr and Nikola Tesla. a lot of the work that I've done, and that goes for Carr, and he related to me, Tesla, did all the work inside. And he got to a point of completing it inside his mind, using his imaging or imagination, and perfecting it in instant time. It doesn't take very long to put the dots together when you're using a power greater than thought, and that's what happened. You can see the picture, and when it works, then you present it, and that presents an element of truth that no matter what the words are spoken, people can see through the words and feel and sense the truth involved in it. So
And you know what, Patty? Your truth is truth.
Yes.
People will see. People are seeing the truth in your story. I mean, we've known you for years, and we've seen some of your
almost all of them.
And we know what you've done, and people will see that beyond what the other appearances are, beyond the Hollywood kinds of things.
Yeah.
Your truth will stand firm.
Beyond Hollywood, I love that. That's a good one.
Well, it is.
Well, and it's not really my truth at all. It's the witnessing of the truth.
Yes.
Thank you.
I didn't master any of this, and I certainly could not hold up my movie camera and tell you the name of any parts other than lens, back, and door that opens. Totally untrained. All I know is I hold it, I keep turning things, and all of a sudden it looks dang good. Headset on, I wait till it sounds good, and I roll. But, you know, the last couple films, I hired a crew because I really want to be in the story, because I know I'm almost done with the pushing of how to get through this old paradigm layering. So here's how we're pushing through, and you guys are, come on, I want my ship. Let's get to the good stuff. I want my ship.
Okay, well, let's see, where do we go from there? Well, eventually I started untying the knots, and I was convinced that it's like a flock of birds. People, humans, were flying in an opposite direction of nature. I mean, 90% was going contrary to natural law. They were exploding things instead of imploding things. They were doing things externally instead of internally. And so I said, well, oh man, I don't know, what am I here to do? And I talked to a tree, and it said, well, you're gonna have to wake them up. And I said, well, how do I do that? It could just come on, I'll show you. And so from then on, Ralph kind of disappeared, and I turned my life over to the tree, or to God, or to nature, or whatever, and said, well, show me the way. And ever since that moment, I've been attached to the universe, or the multiverse, actually, following my feelings, my intuition, and my heart, and love. This has been my guiding light. My pilot light has always been alive and well. I've run into many obstacles along the way, but none I couldn't eventually handle if I was patient. Sometimes I'd be a little impatient, but because of the flack that was thrown at me about, you know, not believing and not sensing or knowing what I was really about. And that was okay, because I found eventually with Marcia, there's an area much more profound than belief. And that is the area of knowing. You can believe something like religion, like science, like medicine, and somebody will come along with a better idea, a different idea, and change your mind. And you have to keep changing that belief to another belief, to another belief. And it goes into a belief system that's a duality, actually diametrically opposed to nature. Because once you see what nature's doing, it's solid. It's, you don't have to believe anymore. You can know. And when you get into knowing, you know when you're hungry, when you're sleepy, when you have to use the restroom, those are all things that they can't possibly get me to disbelieve those things, because they're natural in essence, and they're true in their nature. So that's where the stages of knowing came into being for both Marcia and I. And then we got to a stage of knowing that we know, which is even above knowing. And I thought, well, wait a minute, what does that mean? Well, it's just letting go of everything and knowing that everything is just truth, that has been rearranged, converted, or corrupted into ways that doesn't look like and doesn't feel like truth. And such as the advertising techniques of the system of getting you to do what they want you to do instead of what your body or yourself tells you that you want to do. So we've been telling and sharing and talking with people about get to know yourself and know your feelings. Not, you can take advice and ideas and advertising, but don't buy them. Just take them with a grain of salt until your system says, well, try it. If you don't like it, throw it away or whatever. But wait for your system to kick in and say, this is it, and this is it. And once you've gone there, it's a thrill because you're always at a peaceful state of mind because you know you're not going to be, well, you'll be distracted, but you won't be there very long until you correct your voyage and come back to center. And that makes things just delightful to live, to experience. And Marcia introduced me more to talking to rocks than I had already had, because when I met her, she was already talking to rocks. And
and they talk back.
And they talk back.
I always called it my guiding rock.
And that caused us both to realize everything is in a state of oneness, and we're all fragmented pieces of this oneness. The oneness is who and what we are. And when we are in my study of reflective light versus true nature of light, we're in a little tiny sliver of light that doesn't even hardly exist compared to the light that of reality that lies just beyond the veil or the curtain or whatever you want to call it. And can you help me out here, Pal?
Well, I want you to, and I think we want to get to the spaceship. Yes, okay. Yes, because that's so exciting, and it's such a great thing.
Okay.
Yeah.
Well, I want to say one quick thing.
Okay.
I love to use the word distraction, and I love it that I keep hearing kerlonk, kerlonk, because your audience doesn't know really one of the great aspects of who you are and your heritage. And he's wearing this very large ring that's going kerlonk, kerlonk on the table. Are you willing to briefly introduce your ring?
Oh, well.
And your cross. I mean, I had the privilege of being in their home as a guest for.
Marcia's got one as well. I don't know if
the camera. Oh, so you're both Knights Templar.
Yes.
A little higher.
Okay. It's a multi. Yeah, hard to see. A Maltese cross. Can you see it? I mean, can you? Wait, but the yours is on the bottom. Oh.
I thought you had that big, huge ring last time I was there, Ralph. You had this huge one.
Yes.
You're showing me great. Anyway, let's stay on the spaceship path.
Okay.
But I think it's a fascinating piece that you are both officially Knights Templar, and from that heritage through history, have the wisdom that you have today. I think that that's one thing I kept thinking it was the big ring, because when I met you, you had this ring that was the size of my wrist.
Yeah, I don't know what happened to it, but it's around somewhere. Well, I'd like to correct something at this point. Not correct, just expand something at this point. I've always been a knight. My heritage and my family goes back to knighthood before knighthood was even knighthood. They go back before the Druids and everything. And my cousin, who was a genealogist, decoded all this and gave me a stack of 3 inches tall of my pedigree, and they were all knights or related to knighthood. Knighthood being one who cares more about external help to people than internal. I mean, how do I explain that? Being helpful to others and nothing else, not putting yourself first. Well, when Marcia and I met, she was working for a doctor that happened to be the priory of the Knights Templar, and this was in Prescott, Arizona. And she mentioned it, and I thought, oh, well, I can take this opportunity to see what they're up to. Because in true knighthood, you're united to life itself, to the quest of Christ consciousness, of being help everybody on any level, anytime you can, and given the opportunity. Well, so through a series of things, because we're going to get to the spaceship, Pastor. Why don't you explain that, how that happened?
Well, I was working for Dr. Black and his wife, Carol, and they asked me to become a knight. I knew nothing about knighthood at that point, hardly anything. So I called Ralph, my friend for years and years, and asked him, what do you think? I mean, it was pretty expensive to join this group. You had to buy your robe and everything, and it was, and I was by myself at that time. So he said, Ralph said, oh, but it's such an honor. Do it. So anyway, I did go ahead and send in all the paperwork. You have to be approved in the Knights. It's the military order of the Knights here in the United States. At that time, it only had been here for about 20 years. So probably now maybe 40 years, with the head prior being Queen Elizabeth, not the queen that's, it was another Queen Elizabeth in Sweden, I think. Mm-hmm. Anyway, I did join.
New England.
I became the chaplain of the priory, and I was honored to actually help do prayer over the new knights that came in, which that was Ralph. After the, a couple of years, and when he came in, I was actually part of the ceremony with him. That was such an honor for me.
Yeah, we, in the background, I don't know whether you can see it or not, it's pictures of us being knighted up on the wall.
I don't think so.
And I will get over this. But the point I wanted to make was we got into the Knights and we found, wow, even in the Knights, there's corruption or there's differences. There's contrary to natural law, there seems to be synthetic laws in effect. And they still carry the idea of knighthood being warriors with weapons well, they used them for defense. I realize that, but they weren't using just plain love. So I was guided by a meeting that we had, a round table knight discussion in Phoenix, a big round table, and knights came from all over the world. There was one from Sweden, one from Norway, I forget their names. They came to the meeting. We sat around, and our prior of the Knights was trying to reinforce the ideas of weapons, and not only defensive but offensive, you know, kind of things. He had his home was like a fortress. He had turrets in there, and I went down in his basement. He had a full arsenal down there and all these guns and everything, and I said, well, okay, I can be of service here by trying to get him to go back to love instead of fear, because fear is always the outcome of weapons. You have to be fearful to carry weapons. Long story short, I got an audience with him, one morning, that I was set there by nature to stress my case, which is, John, we got to use love. We got to get back to the principles of love and caring and no more fear and doubts, because that's what the Knights have become. What I've seen in this present knighthood, there's a lot of fear involved. Not all of the Knights are that way, but we talked for about 3 or 4 hours, and he says, well, you know, we've been doing this for a long time, Ralph, and I appreciate your input, but we're not going to be able to change our ways of doing things, because that's too much of a challenge for us to change from one way to another. And I said, well, you could do it gradually. I mean, you don't know. He said, no. So then in my heart, I knew that was the end of my experience with the conventional knight.
But during this round table experience, this was in Sedona, Arizona, it was such an amazing time, because the prior was guiding everything to the armor, and he had all of these the guns and everything. And the two knights that came from Sweden and Norway came over and sat beside Ralph and I. And
thank you. That was my whole
yes.
Thank you, honey. And told us. I said, well, why aren't you up there talking with the rest of the knights about the armor and everything? He said, no, we're not here for that. We're here to talk to you and Marcia. And I said, well, what about what? Well, you two are here to bring light back into the night. And that struck me pretty strong. It struck Marcia the same way. Well, to bring light back into the night. And so I realized
it didn't happen. We just like yeah. you, we worked well it, with it.
It is happening now. Is. And we know knights that have pulled away. They've called themselves rogues, or they've called themselves, in fact, there is a small group of them called silent knights. They don't ever blow their own whistle or blow their own horn. They just find a place that nature says there's a need here. And they fulfill it. And their reward is in being able to fulfill it.
Yeah.
What we have is an infiltrated world right now. All the great agencies, all the great industries have been infiltrated with those that are trying to destroy us. But the good thing is that we have enough white knights that have infiltrated into their little areas of controldom where they don't even realize they're being filmed from the inside out, and hopefully soon this great jubilee that's almost upon us, hopefully today, tomorrow. I mean, I'm just like, you know, checking my hairs on my arm going, are we there yet? Has the new paradigm started? And again, this is where no matter what's going on for me in the world, I keep saying, I see the carrot.
Yes.
And so with my workshops coming up at the event that I'm speaking at this summer, Contact in the Desert in May, it's been an interesting interplay where, you know, being a whistleblower, there's people that don't really love having you around because perhaps they don't feel safe with, shoot, there's that girl who's all telepathic and intuitive and she takes no crap. Yes, that's me, hi. And I'm the best friend you could ever have, but if you're a lying sack, you don't want to be near me or my friends. And that's what's happening now, is we're coming out. We're saying, hi, I'm telepathic, and don't bother lying. My favorite thing now is watching the most famous speakers say, hi, I'm telepathic, and I'm really, really good at what I do, and I'm so famous, and they're headed right for a sinkhole, and I watch them fall in. And I'm like, wow. Telepathic there, pretty psychic there. And it's nonstop watching this circus now. But I go to all the big events where I've been a speaker for years, but now that my mouth has, shall we say, grown, I don't hold back like I used to. And I'll still drink tea with my pinky up, but if you lie to me, you will see the back of my head so quickly. So here's two people who actually, We're here to try and rescue the Knights Templar. This is a very important piece. I thought we were only talking spaceships, but Alfred, is that kind of an interesting story for you? He muted out.
Sorry, he's just like I had to mute. Yes, I've been watching all of this unfold, and I've been the languaging and the very deep and as Ralph and Marcia go into the deep natural languaging and navigate through concepts that are more than philosophical but actually real. I think that they're manifesting what many people have carried as, you know, in a metaphysical or a philosophical basis. Ralph and Marcia really are manifesting that and and it's the reality that they're actually living. I mean, when Ralph used the phrase "the light of reality," that jumped out at me so quickly because it evoked for me the description in Dr. Michael Newton's work, where he talks about souls in the interlife, talking about the creation of souls and what source looks like. And he says, oh, if source is like a sea of light, and it was very evocative. And you know, maybe we were just in the midst of source. We're actually in a field that is light. We're in a field of source. And maybe that's what moving up into 5D is. And so this is very exciting. When you say, let's get to the spaceship, what I kept hearing was, but we're in the spaceship. So anyway, yeah. So please, this is just amazing for me. And I really appreciate it. Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Well, I did want to say that I grew up in nature also, and I live in nature now. And I've had not a pet, but a friend fox in every house I've ever lived in. I draw foxes like having a dog. I don't pet them, but we spend a lot of time together. And I've got one here now, comes morning and night. We just visit. But I think that, and I wrote it in my upcoming workshop, which is called Tools for the New Paradigm Reality. One of them is realizing that the work we've done with wildlife, which is a very important part of my life because I live in the woods. I've got herds of deer and I can brush shoulders with them, you know, walk into my car and they're like, hey. So it's a lack of resistance. And I feel the same thing with ET contact as I do with wildlife contact, which is that when we're in their presence and we're in our full consciousness, it's up to us to listen and feel what they're saying and who they are and change our frequency to meet them.
Yes.
And then we have the language. If we come in and start our human rampage or sending out these big, you know, telegraphic, it's not the listening. And the crop circles being delivered, all we have to do is look at them. Now, if you stand in it, then you get wafted with all the frequencies, but still, the messages are there. All you have to do is look at them. Yeah. But everybody's going, hey, look what Elon Musk is doing. The billions of dollars. Wow, look TV. And the BBC goes running. And, you know, on the other hand, Elon, excuse me, there's a crop circle next door. They left you a message, like a love note. Elon, or, you know, whoever they are. Hey, Boeing. Hey, NASA. There's a love letter in the field next door, but they're too busy. So we're in this interesting shift where I'm focusing on this work and the white knights going into every aspect. That's what my job is, I guess, with media. I didn't get thrown into the industry to go into war with bullies. This is like the last thing I want to waste my time on. So I'm loving it that I know all the important players, I think, in the new paradigm, and that all you guys are showing up and doing these shows. We're getting it out there. So how did the workings of the ship come about? I never heard the beginning of how you got interested and figured it out.
Okay, I'll just round off the end of the knighthood thing for you by saying we were invited to speak at the Arendal Castle in England. And from there, I wanted to see Tintagel. I wanted to see the remnants of Camelot. So we went on to Tintagel. We had a wonderful time there. The feelings, the energy field was just so high that I was in heaven there. Just the feelings of whatever the heritage, whatever the rumors, whatever it was, and whatever it is still to this day, was still radiating in our hearts from the visit we made. And I brought that up for a reason I can't remember.
About the knighthood.
Yeah.
I spent a night at Tintagel.
Did you? Uh-huh. Yeah.
I spent a night in the castle. I didn't even know why. It's the Knights Templar stuff?
Yes.
I was there.
Wow.
So what happened?
Oh, well, okay. The reason I brought that up was I want to tie it back into crop circles. The reason I brought it up was we were invited to tour England for a while before we had to go to our next conference or whatever it was. And so we were to see Stonehenge and Adbury, and the place that stuck was, we went to, was it Salisbury Castle? Glastonbury. I love Glastonbury. It was beautiful there, and the well and the tour and everything. But in Salisbury, we were guided to walk out in the field about a mile. It was really a long walk, and it was foggy and wet and damp and muddy. But we came to this underground cavern system, the tunnel system that we found. And we explored that and everything with our guide. We had a guide with us at the time. And we didn't know till we got back to Adbury. And went into a gift store. They had just taken a picture of this crop circle that happened at the same time we were there at Salisbury. It was the next field over or something. We couldn't see it, and we didn't know it, but we were that close. We were that close.
It was so exciting.
Yeah, very exciting to us.
The Avebury Stone Circle, and you were in a store called The Henge.
Yes.
You were in all of my stomping grounds. Yeah, that's the epicenter of crop circle deliveries.
Oh,
I love that.
Yeah,
so and I could actually walk up and feel the energy in the big, huge boulders that were there.
Mm-hmm.
But we couldn't in Henge.
Stonehenge.
We couldn't go up there.
Well, they locked it all off because
Avebury is so beautiful. I love that.
So that's where you got your stimulation?
Well, I got a lot of stimulation there. It's not the only place, but that was very, very stimulated. And when I saw the picture of the crop circle, which is one of yours that you had in your repertoire, I was just absolutely speechless, because we were that close and nature was bringing us close enough to feel the energy, even though we didn't visually see it with our eyes, we felt it with our soul, and we saw it with our high energy. So I guess that rounds off the knighthood for now anyway, and I'll go on with the spaceship. What happened then was, and we were touring Europe. We went to the Netherlands to talk at the Breakthrough Energy Movement. And that's where I met a lot of other people like ourselves, like Michael Tallinger, and oh my gosh, we were scores of people. And it was good. And then we went on to England and
Stephanie Paulus.
Yeah.
Our sweet friend. But anyway, this was like in 2012 that we did this tour. But before, in 1959, tell your story.
Okay.
How did you meet Carr?
Okay. I got out of the service. I was in the army, and I went to Korea, and I got many. I was at the front line. We were in the 3rd Division, 7th Regimental Combat Team, which is a glorified outfit that Audie Murphy happened to belong to. And we were right on the front line. And I couldn't stay there because I kept getting wounded. And I kept coming back for rest and recuperation, going back. And pretty soon, the 300 of us that went over, we were taken off for Guam and sent over there on the Wonchon Landing. We were the first ones in Korea, rescuing the Marines that were surrounded up at Chosan Reservoir. I don't want to go too far into this either, but
Well, 300 we know.
Oh yeah. Well, anyway, I got wounded and it came back. But I kept putting in for engineering school and they kept putting me back in the infantry. So when I got back, I expected to go into engineering school. I wanted to become a classic engineer. Well, it didn't happen because the funds that were put aside for me to go to school were no longer available when I got back to the States. And I finally eventually got discharged in San Francisco. Let's see, where am I here? I'm getting into tangents and I don't want to get into.
Well, you did get married, you had two children.
Yeah.
It's getting inspired to make the ship.
I said I've got to do something to effectively feel the honor of being here and being able to be somebody responsible for waking up my brothers and sisters. And so that's always been on my mind. I didn't know how to do that. And so I got out of the service. I tried to find a job, and the only thing I could count a job on. I'm going too fast. I'm sorry. I got out, and I was in the military for so long. I was in for 5 years. The only thing I was involved with was military armory and big guns and machine guns and stuff. And I looked in the paper, there's no ads for those kind of people. What am I gonna do? So on Guam, when I was there, I learned how to skin dive. And I'm gonna cut it short. And when I came back, I realized, well, the only thing I could do is skin dive. I'm gonna run an ad, I'm a skin diver, and I can go look for your sunglasses or your binoculars or investigate claims for the insurance or whatever. And I started a skin diving business in San Francisco. That went on for quite a while, and that allowed me to be a little more fluent, a little more financially fluent. Would that be the word?
Okay. Sure.
So I kept saying, well, I want to get into a spot where I can help people wake up, because everything I talked about was nonsense to everybody. I mean, they said, oh man, you're cuckoo talking about outer space and space beings and spaceships. And I said, no, I'm not. That's a natural thing that in my research, I found that they've always been here. We just got into a state we got a little rough and decided to disrupt the frequency of spaceships and started downgrading ourselves into vehicles that are very expensive to run, very expensive to buy and to run and everything. And I said, well, heck, we can get back to spaceships. I can do that. So I'm going to cut to the chase. Eventually wound up going to work because of my wife at the time. She was afraid of my diving experiences. I worked for U.S. Divers, which was Jacques Cousteau, and I did a lot of diving off Catalina and Santa Cruz Islands. And my wife said, you're getting too many close calls there, and you got kids, and I need the trash taken out. You better find a better job. Now I need you at home. So one day the newspaper was on the breakfast table, and it was circled with lipstick around an ad of wanted a lab tech for advanced kinetics in Costa Mesa, California. And I said, well, so, and she said, well, you got all this stuff running around here on magnetic power. Because if the house was rigged magnetically, I didn't have to do much because it was taking care of itself. She says, why don't you go down there and try and get a job? I says, why? I haven't got a background. I've been a diver. And I was then a war veteran and a little machine shop when I was a kid. But I don't know what she said. Just go down there and just talk to them. You don't know about natural law. Tell them about natural law. So I said, okay. So I went down. I got there. It was noontime and everybody was on break. And I said, hello, hello. And nobody was around, not even the receptionist was there. And so I was about ready to come back home and I passed the director's office, Dr. Weinhardt was his name. And this was advanced kinetics. And he says, what are you doing? And I said, well, I'm looking for a job. And he said, what kind of a job? And I said, well, my experience has been with natural laws and stuff, and I'd like to, you know, share what I've learned about simplicity, because I noticed that most of the things that are put together by conventional ways are very complicated, and you have to have years of research and reference libraries, and that's not necessary, because if you use your intuition, this can be done overnight. And he liked the way I was talking, and he said, well, coincidentally, because I told him my main interest was magnetics, an engineer just quit his job. He just walked off the job in a magnetic experiment that they were working with. And he said, okay, well, you sound pretty good to me. Go to work. And I said, well, I haven't even filled out a, no, don't worry about that. You'll do it later. Just go in there, because we, every minute down on this job cost us money. So I went in. What it was trying to get an electron through a magnetic field. And I had a oscilloscope and a Polaroid camera and giant size and a cathode ray tube that was shooting electrons. And all I had to do was shoot an electron and try and get it through the field without deflection to the negative or positive side of the magnet. And thousands of times I'd press the button and they kept telling me, increase the Gauss, increase the pressure. We've got Boulder Dam behind us. You can use as much force as necessary. But I said, wait a minute, you're going to use force on this little guy? That's not never going to work, because nature doesn't like force. And so I said, wait a minute, I'm going to go home and I'll find a better way of doing this and I'll bring it in, see what you say about it. So the next bench over there working on levitation, and they were just having a giant coil with a little steel ball levitating for 3 or 4 minutes, and then have to go to get another coil because they burn it up. And I said, oh no, I can do that. So I went home on my living room floor, which was my lab at the time. I the setup, I took the magnets out of the television set and speaker arrangement, and I set up my experiment that I had at work, which was $150,000 machine that I was working with, to probably a $45 setup that I got at garage sales and put it all together. But all it was a magnet with its positive and negative field around it, and I set up a cathode ray tube out of the same television set. That's a standard in those days to have a cathode ray tube. That was my gun. But I was talking, because of my nature, I was talking to the little electron. I said, I'm sorry, those guys were forcing you, but I'm not going to force you now. Tell me what you'd like to do. I'm metaphoring, of course, but tell me what you'd like to do here. And he said, well, give me a chance to breathe. You're pushing me beyond breathing. Everything in life consists of inhaling and exhaling. It's always the counter rotation of life that goes on forever. And when you're pushing it in one direction all the time, you're never gonna get anywhere but destruction. So I said, well, okay, what would you like to do? Well, I'm gonna go through the field for you, but give me a little space. And I said, okay, instead of pushing the button and trying to force you, which I never would thought of anyway, I'm going to pulse the signal in milliseconds and give you a couple of milliseconds. And the electron to me in my metaphoric way said, okay, great, let's try it. So I fired it up and the little guy, instead of trying to force its way through, went into a spiral, which is vortexes. It went into the spiral, circulating between positive and negative, and went all the way through the field, first time without deflection. I said, hooray, bingo, we're gonna get a new house, I'm gonna get a new car. I'm gonna write this up and take pictures of it and turn it in. Well, then I got excited about this levitation thing. I said, oh, that's simple. And I got the speaker out of this same set and put it on the floor, laid it on flat on its back, and hooked up an audio amplifier that I got at a garage sale for about $25, and kept experimenting with different objects to get them to levitate. It was acoustic levitation, but I had seen a year or two before, a film, an 8mm film on the Tibetans in Tibet, lifting these giant stones with big horns and drums. Whoa, they create this tremendous resonant frequency of the stones, and the stones would go up the side of the cliff, and they were, and Laos was built by these stones being lifted up with natural levitation, by reaching the resonant frequency of something. So I said, okay, so I keep trying these objects and see if I can reach the resonant frequency. And finally, I got a ping pong ball to come up, and they got very happy just staying right there in the center. I couldn't hear anything, but the ping pong ball was levitating. I pushed it down, it came back up. I said, that's enough. I can turn it over to the engineers and they can take it from there, because this doesn't cost anything. And they can find their ways of doing things and change them, and we'll get somewhere with levitation. Well, I wrote that up, took pictures, took it into Dr. Weinhardt. I showed him, I told him, and he eventually said, you know, Ralph, I really have to tell you something here. I'm a physicist, I'm full-blown, I've got all these degrees and all this. And he says, I never thought anybody would get that far with things. And he said, that's really far out and stuff. And I said, yeah, I know, but what do you think? And he says, well, unfortunately, I'm going to have to tell you, I'm going to have to enlighten you on what we do here. This is a government-funded research and development laboratory. And we are now funded by the federal government to look for answers, but not find them. Right. And that was a killer. That stabbed me right through the heart. And that reminded me of built-in obsolescence that I've heard somebody tell me about, that they only build them to last so long, to fail so they can make more money, more money, more money. And I said, well, that sounds like the money thing to me. We didn't elaborate on it, but he said, we can't go any further than this, because we have to keep looking for the answers. And the ones that we find are not for public, that's private. And I said, what do you mean private? I didn't talk to him about this, but I thought it. And then later on, I found out that was the black ops, that all these things at work were going to another shadow system that was operating with partially with natural law, but they were using electromagnetism, not magnetism. There's a big difference. And they have yet to realize the difference. Anyway, so he said, I'm going to have to shred these and tell you to go back to work. There'll be more money in your envelope, but I don't want you to talk to the engineers or anything about this. Just go back to work. Well, I went back to work, and it lasted about a week, and I had to quit. I went out of there with tears, because I said, man, I thought I was here to help. And they were shutting me down, trying to shove money at me and have me stay somewhere that I honestly felt was useless. I'd never get anywhere with this job. At that time, my buddy was working on an electron microscope in the same facility. And he said, come over for lunch. I want to show you something. Because we've been talking about unusual, magical, phenomenal, esoteric things. And one of them was about energy, what energy is and so forth. So he says, I want to show you something. And he rigged up something on his microscope that I could stick my finger into. And he says, now take a look at your finger. What do you got there? And I said, well, that's solid. There's a, definitely a form there, flesh and blood and everything. He said, no, there isn't. And I said, I'm touching it. I know what I, he says, stick your finger in here and take a look. I looked in the electron microscope and there was no finger. It's just energy. That's all we are, is energy. We're perceived by perception. We perceive energy. We create energy by our perceptions instantly, in nanoseconds, actually. So we think, oh, this has always been here. But we're living life in nanoseconds. It keeps reproducing itself naturally for a very, very pleasant reason. I mean, we can enjoy everything and anything. The trouble is, the synthetic beings have gone to all this work of years of study before they get anywhere, and it usually doesn't last or doesn't work very good when they don't have to. They can do the same thing with their mind. And so, help.
Well, you only lasted about a week.
And oh, and I walked out with tears, and I had to go home and face my wife because she was going to be upset that I'd quit the job. I ran in. Oh, something I should share with the audience at this point. The University of Minnesota has developed in their science department, Dr. I can't think of his name right now, but this is on YouTube. You can go to YouTube and type in mind over mechanics, mind over mechanics. And it shows the actual demonstration in their gymnasium of operating vehicles in the air, suspending them, levitating them with the mind, using diodes on the brain, and they can levitate and have it go up, down, around, or spin. And I said, well, that's proving my point, that you don't have to go to all this expense and time to create something. You can use your mind. So I just wanted to put that in there, because if people are doubting that you can do things with your mind, that's a good one to watch, because this is a very credible university and a very credible experience to watch. Back to the story. I was coming out of...
It's the essence of how you got that ship to dissipate.
Yes. Yeah. So I was coming out of the Dance Canates, and I ran into a friend of mine, a neighbor, and he said, what's wrong? And he looked down. I said, yeah, I got to go home and face the music. I just quit. And I don't know what I'm going to do. And he said, well, you're always talking about spaceships and floating homes and floating cities and floating countries. Yeah. He says, why don't you come over to my meeting with me? It's called Understanding. It was created by a person by the name of Dr. Daniel Fry in Costa Mesa, California. And they talk about things like this, and I think you'll be accepted there for what you are doing, not what you're not doing. So I went over and I talked to him, and I told him about magnetics, and that I love magnetics, and there's no reason that we have to do anything. We can use magnetic power, which is really etheric power, if we accept it, to do everything for us. All we have to do is be ourselves and use our minds in a constructive way, and it'll all happen. It's given to us. So they said, well, you sound like a guy named Otis Carr he's a direct disciple of Tesla. He worked with Tesla for 3 years. He was a clerk supplementing his education and his experiments. He was working at the New Yorker Hotel in New York as a clerk. And he became acquainted with Tesla because Tesla was always bugging him to get more peanuts to feed the pigeons with. And he'd go to Central Park and feed them, and then when he wasn't in Central Park, he'd have a car come up and help him feed the pigeons at his suite. Well, Carr was a sponge, and he was very in love with natural law himself. And when he got to talking with Tesla, he says, well, you sound like a candidate that might be able to carry this further than I've gotten, because they're shutting me down. Morgan pulled the strings on the money because and tore down my tower, and in the they had it's called Wardenclyffe Tower in northern Manhattan, and he tore it all down because I had told him we no longer need to tear down trees to make telephone poles or dig holes in the ground for copper. We can transport power through the air. It's natural. It's very simple. There's no wires ever needed. And we can have enough energy. In those days, we called it free energy. They don't like those words today, so we call it alternative energy. And for everybody, and nobody will have to ever have to worry about energy again. But when the backer, J.P. Morgan, heard about it, he says, oh, no, man, there's no money in that. What are you talking about? We've got people, thousands of people making money off of telephone poles and copper wiring and stuff. And we're going to have to pull your plug, which they did. Long story short, they tore down his tower. They told him to get lost and stuff. And so he went into seclusion somewhat. And confided in Carr, he said, I want to tell you everything I can, and I want you to take it to the next level. And that might get turned down and stop, but to keep passing the torch until someday that people will listen. Free energy, or I'm going to use that phrase, I like it, is available. It's always been available. Somebody came along and said, let's put meters on it and make money. And that was a monetary system that became so strong, it became a giant and the ruler of the whole system. And the only way we're going to go back to free and abundant energy is if you keep talking and demonstrating and showing them physical evidence that free energy is alive and well. So Carr said, I will. And he went on and created the OTC enterprise. In Baltimore, Maryland, he had a big laboratory, huge. He finally got started in it. And they were building all kinds of alternative devices, not only the idea of spaceships, but all kinds of little devices that you could put in your home and fire them up, and they would eventually start synergizing with your machinery. 60 cycles was hard to deal with because it's a dangerous. 60 cycles is dangerous. And Carr worked with vibrations instead of electrical currents. Honey, can you say something for a minute? I got to breathe. Just say something.
This story.
I'm trying to get it all in.
This story.
I'm trying to get the speech.
It is so amazing. It's just an amazing story. And one thing, can I tell about the book?
Of course you can tell.
And I wasn't there. This is all Ralph's story. But Otis Carr told all of his crew at one point that he had written a book on poems. And
but why did he write the book? Can I put that
yes,
in?
Yes, please do.
He went to the patent office. He worked hard enough to get a patent. I mean, he got prototypes working on alternative energy. These spaceships, little spaceships. And he took it to the patent office, says, I want a patent on this because I want to develop it for people instead of the cars. They can have the cars, but they got this too. Well, the patent office looked at it and said, wait a minute, you're talking levitation, you're talking teleportation. That is not in conventional science. We can't use this. The only thing we can give you a patent on is an amusement device. And we will do that if you'll pull those things out. All the wonderful, simplistic things of the craft had to be pulled out, and he got a patent for an amusement device, which he eventually set up in Norman, Oklahoma, in an amusement park. But go ahead, honey.
Are you okay?
Yeah, go ahead.
Well, anyway, he wrote this book, and it's Dimensions of Mystery, and he told
it's on our website if anybody's interested in looking at it. The website's bluestarenterprise.com, and it's their free download, and they can look at it.
The original copy's on the website, and then Carr told his crew, Ralph being part of it, that when it was decoded, all of these poems and everything was decoded, it would tell the story of how to build the spaceship.
People would be able to eventually build their own in the comfort of their own living room. They could build devices, alternatives, and in the advent of the 3D printers, they'll be able to make their own devices without having to count on or depend upon a system that cost them an arm and a leg to even think about it, let alone doing it. So
one of our pods in Australia,
God bless him,
I know, he actually,
I'm going to mention his name because he's angelic angel to me. His name is Ben Hallen, and he's in Australia, and he's been working for 4 years on reproducing our spaceships. We've had several models, several prototypes that he keeps improving every month. He's found another way of improving them to the point where we're now in a holding pattern waiting for the consciousness to raise high enough to accept the principles involved. And the activation has to be done with the consciousness to know that you can use your mind. You don't need ignition switches and steering wheels anymore. You can use your mind to operate these craft. So he's at that point now, and we're kind of in a limbo.
He actually decoded this book, and the decoded copy is also on the website. So
all
the
three.
Original copy is there, and the
decoded copy.
But anyway, go ahead.
Go ahead, honey.
Well, it's about your story.
Oh, it's my turn.
It's your turn. It's about the spaceship when you met Carr.
Okay.
So you were going. You went to
the understanding group. Very beautiful, benevolent people. Just gorgeous, because all they wanted was truth. That was the whole idea. To understand truth, opposed to the falsehoods that they'd been fed. In growing up and in jobs, and everything they did was falsehoods, and they joined this group, and we had people from all walks of life, and I told them my story, and they said, well, you sound like a guy that's in Norman, Oklahoma right now demonstrating his prototypes of a spaceship, and he wants to do the same thing. And I'd love to put you guys together because you sound like you belong together. So long story short, because he was running into trouble there, they tried to shut him down, and they tried everything. They tried to discredit him and all kinds of stuff. So the understanding group pooled their resources and invited him and his entourage, come on to California. We want to give you a chance to do what you want to do. Long story short, him and his entourage, which was about eight, I think there was eight people, engineers, physicists, PR people and stuff, came out to California. We joined together in the understanding group in Costa Mesa. And when I met Carr, man, I was just like, oh, whoa, this guy is talking my language, and vice versa. We just got into hours and hours of conversations about beautiful things. And everybody's looking at everything the wrong way. The perceptions of things are backwards. They don't see the beauty. They see only what they can make out of it or make from it, and not experience the energy field that this beauty would give you if you took the time to enjoy it. So the understanding group says, well, we've done some research, and things are moving along. And we've got a giant cabin up in Lake Arrowhead, California. It's up in the woods. And we'd like all you guys, they're large enough to accommodate all of you, go up there and wait, and we'll get things rolling for you and find a place to work. Now, this at this point in the understanding group was of a high enough caliber or high enough level in their consciousness to use what we call manifestation. They knew that they were working on divine principles, not an authentic principles, not synthetic. And so they knew this is happening and we're all a part of this. So everybody.
We gotta get on the. You gotta get in the picture
okay.
here.
Okay, I'll move the camera.
Okay, there you go.
Sorry.
Okay.
So.
Sorry, you went up to Lake Arrowhead.
Oh yeah, and so we went up to Lake Arrowhead, and I really got in the car then, and we spend all night, and all day, just enjoying each other's company, and not eating. We didn't even have to eat. We were absorbing our energy from the field that we were feeling from our conversations. And it was just so outstandingly beautiful. Beyond words, it was an area that we'd only just mention a word, yeah, got it. It was way beyond the conventional way of communicating. And we came to the idea we're going to work together to raise the consciousness, because if we don't raise the consciousness, they're not going to accept the craft. But we can use the craft, because they're always interested in external things, to raise the consciousness. So if we create the spaceship and show that it works and everything, and say, here, you can have it, but do you have the consciousness to operate it? Because they won't. The operating tools are in the on the inside, using their internal mechanisms, or their intuition and their heart, which consists of much love, to operate it. That's the only thing that would operate it. I said, go, let's do that. We got a phone call from Understanding Group. They said, we found this enormous facility, warehouse, as big as a blimp hangar in Hesperia, Apple Valley, California, where you guys got it. It's all taken care of. You go down there, it's already got machine shops and tool and die, and they've got all the facilities there for accommodations, offices, and bunks and everything. Go to work. So we went. We brought down there and we started. we got down there and very, very happy that we finally had a place to work. Quietly and privately. We were out in kind of a desert then. There was nothing around us. And so we set up shop and we started proceeding to build alternative devices. And the car had the idea, we're going to have to make models and get them out to kids as fast as we can, of showing them how they can build these little models themselves. And eventually, they will figure out ways to get them to operate. And I thought, well, at the time, gee, that's no guidance. It's the guidance, before they get too old, they've got the guidance built into them, and they can figure it out before they get too old and too conditioned, and then it'll drop away. But you build these toys for kids, and they'll be able to figure out a way to get these things to work. So we were building toys. We had another department that was building toys and replicas, and we were advertising them. And we contacted Mattel's toy company or something, and they agreed, well, we can put these on the market or something. And that was all starting to go very well. In the meantime, our research got to the point where our prototypes were such that we were operating them fully levitational, off the ground, flying them all over Apple Valley and San Bernardino County.
And how big were vehicles that you were flying around?
These were 12-inch, three-footers, six-footers. We had different, because we were still in the experimental stages. These were small, but...
And it was in the 60s.
This was in the late 50s, uh-huh.
Late 50s, okay.
And now let me bring in James Gilliland.
Oh, yeah.
You know of James Gilliland in Washington?
Of course. Yeah.
Well, he observed all our craft that were flying around.
He was a young boy.
He was a boy.
Probably.
He was a little boy then.
I think he was.
And he says, Mom, I got to go see these things. This is driving me crazy. They're coming from over there. I know where they're at. And his mom said, no, stay away from that. That must be a government thing. You don't go there and don't.
But he tells about it on his shows, and we've been interviewed by him.
In his interviews, he talks about seeing our prototypes all over the valley. And they thought they were flying saucers at the time. There were our experiments, and they related to flying saucers. But and then later he stopped scratching my head.
Okay. He's your co-producer. Well, wait a minute. So I'm not hearing any ET inspiration yet in your story. This is all consciousness, how you created the OTCX1, reinvented. It's not ET. This is consciousness. Or am I wrong?
It comes to a definition of ET that is very, very delicate right now, because people think there's a division between us and them. There is no division in life. It's all one. And we are them and they are we. It just depends on the way you perceive it. And while we were building the craft, we had visitors coming in and helping us, just being benevolent, just being loving and caring. They'd come in and, hey, you guys, how you doing? And acting just like one of us. I mean, no difference. I didn't know then what I know now, and except when they would leave, because they were so benevolent, is the only word I can use. We thought, who were those guys? And I used to, my mentor when I was a kid was the Lone Ranger. So the closing of an episode with the Lone Ranger was, who was that masked man? And so when these guys would leave, I'd say, let's go see where they're going. Because they weren't like us, but yet they were. But we were perfectly natural. I mean, nothing extraordinary, no difference. And they just got out the door 60 seconds at the most. And we went out and looked. No car, no people.
Gone.
Gone. Yeah. Completely gone. Yeah. Wow. So we're being helped. So they were
okay. Gone.
There you go.
And they urged us to keep going for magnetic energy, because that's not even known in the vernacular of in the composition of physics on this planet. They think electromagnetism is it. Electromagnetism can be warped into a dangerous situation. They can mount weapons on electromagnetism. They can use electromagnetism as weapons. Psychotronic weapons are electromagnetism. But stay with magnetism, because that's in all of the multiverse, that is love. Magnetism is equated to love. And when you're using love, there is no danger, never a danger on any level. So they kept urging us to use love. And so we proceeded. And incidentally, James Gilligan, on one of his talks, mentioned it, and I didn't know this at the time, but when I had the experience with a 45-foot craft, which I'll bring up because this is leading to it, the two police officers were on duty around the valley, and they saw us come down and levitate at a spot in the desert. They saw three people get out of the craft and pick up some stuff, get back in, and disappear. James Gilligan said he viewed that along with the police. We got an email from the police officers years later that, yeah, I was there, I saw it. And then James Gilligan said, I saw it too. So anyway, I needed that proof of witnesses, because people were thinking, by this time I was totally bananas. And so we kept working on it, and our prototypes were working efficiently. And we were working, we had one completely, it was at the stage of, it was operational. And the other 45-foot craft, we're still working on it. But the one we had operational, I became very close with, I bonded with Carr on a spiritual level, if you want to use that word. It's a level beyond explanation, just, wow, we're one here, buddy. let's get this job done. And so I was gifted when he decided we, before that, I got to bring up General Motors, I guess, yeah. But I will say this, I was fortunate enough and very gifted enough and blessed enough to be one of the three people that got on the craft and had this experience, because I understood natural law. And that was the whole reason. I mean, it just, I understood everything from a natural point of view, not from anything else. I'll get back to that, but I have to back up a little, because we got to the point where we were running on our shoestrings. There was a radio program. This is also on our website. People can go in. There's 16 programs now that they can download from visitors from other other frames of reference, dimensions, planets, anywhere, that came through KBG. It's on the website. I can't remember, but and talked about things in truth, all truth, magnetics, spaceships, the profile of man was one of them. There is no death. There's another one. And they're all coming from a state of truth. And you can tune in and listen to these things now. And I was reluctant to put them back out on in the public till just recently. And then I said, no, this is from space beings coming to us. And these were the same people that were helping us build the craft. Let's get them out on the market. So I just instructed our new webmaster to put them out. And 2 weeks ago, they posted them. So they're on the website called Galaxy Programs. That's the name of them.
And let me just point and just say something here for him. The Galaxy, what was the man's name, Richard?
Miller.
Miller. And this was back in 1950s. Mm-hmm. That he actually put these out to the public, but it's his voice, but each voice is like an alien, a different name and a different vibration. And he tells different things about scientific, it pertains to right now today. Yeah. I mean, it was way before
it's
time.
It's just plain truth. I mean, it pertains to every way of life forever.
They're very interesting. It's actually, you can tell the voice is put on differently, but it's actually aliens telling this whole scientific way of what's happening even today.
In a way, a gentle way of not scaring people, right. Not getting people overly excited or too excited to use their own logic or reason. And so they got it through a radio broadcast, and it lasted long enough to impress a lot of different people. And we found out that part of our funding to keep operational were people involved in the program and the listeners of the program. They said, we want to help build these spaceships. So we get private funding to keep us going in our prototypes. But we were kind of on a volunteer basis. We didn't care about the dang money as long as we had enough to eat and everything. We were okay, but we did get enough funds to keep going.
I want to talk about how the craft runs on consciousness. This was the biggest piece for me, sitting around your round table for 3 days with a couple of other extremely bright people. Thank you, Mark Cuthbert, for bringing us together.
Yes.
And Terry, who was there. But when you described how the craft runs on consciousness, we're talking about a 45-foot diameter, huge craft, vehicle, made of, tell us what it's made of, tell us if it's smooth like the ET ships, what was it literally like, and how, take us on the journey where the three of you were in a line of all the media and the guys from GM, and how you, I had this image, I've never let it go, walked up the plank into the craft, explain that day, and how the craft dissipated with the three of you in it. I think this is the most outstanding moment of this show. Here we go.
Okay, coming right
drum
up.
Drum roll.
Okay, just before that, we were at the stage, we were running short on funds. We didn't know where we were going to, how are we going to manufacture these for people? Well, call General Motors, call Ford, call somebody. So our PR man, which was Wayne Aho, Major Wayne Aho, that joined us, was our PR man, contacted General Motors. They sent a rep out, and we sat down in the Riverside, I think it was, California, and we brought, Carr brought our little 12-inch model in a briefcase to explain to General Motors, we want to take the wheel from a vertical position, which is requiring cement and asphalt and tearing down all the trees and the foliage and killing animals off of this position and putting in a horizontal position and having another vehicle that will operate on magnetic energy. Well, General Motors said, what are you talking about, magnetic? Well, we're breathing it. Everything we do is magnetic. Everything we do. There's nothing but magnetism in the universe. And we can use that forever without ever running out of fuel, without ever running out of building materials, because you can build using magnetic energy. And the rep thought we were crazy, of course, and he had a couple of engineers with him and a physicist. And he says, well, just what are you talking about here? Can you give me a demonstration? And Carr popped his briefcase open, and we stood back, me and two other engineers and Carr, and the craft came up out of the little briefcase and went around the room and over his desk and looked at it. And the engineers went bonkers. They couldn't believe we're doing this. And they said, well, it must be remotes. Well, that was before the technology we have now. We didn't have anything like that. They said, could you take your coats off? And they scanned us for some kind of a remote. Said, no, we're using our mind. You know, we're just using our mind here. We didn't put it that simple, but we said, no, everybody can do this. There's nothing extraordinary about this. It's just, we're not doing it. We're using another form of technology, and it doesn't have to be. Well, the engineers, we had a Lexan or a cover on the top of the craft where you could look into the cabin. We wanted that to be obvious to the people that would inspect it. And the first thing they asked was, where's the ignition switch? Where's the steering wheel? He said, no, it's operated by our mind. Collectively, we are focusing on the resonant frequency of the craft. It operates on its own frequency. It has its own vibratory rate. And when we synchronize with that, we become one with the craft, and we can move it with our minds because we're in sync with it. And the craft is a friend of ours. We enjoy the craft as a state of consciousness. Well, this got the guy into a ballistic state of, I can't even put a word on it, but he didn't want any more to do it. He said, we got hundreds of thousands of people. You know what, General Moore, we were all over the world. We have people in every country. We can't, you're gonna take away their living, their kids living, their everything, you're gonna all teach it. No, and Carr said, no, let me explain. If you will allow us to build these craft, they will replace, because of the ingredients necessary to build these, will replace the necessary stuff that you're using now, and people will no longer have to toil for a living. They can go back to being who they really are and what they really want to do with their life, which is being in love with everything they do and everybody they meet. And this drove this guy up the wall. He says, man, you guys are outlaws because you're going against the system here. And Carr said, no. People are working from the clock every day. They come home, they're so tired, they can't think, they got to go to sleep to get up and punch the clock again. If you give them, take away the clock, take away all of that and let them be what they came here to be, is a inventive, creative, loving being. Well, the guy says, Mr. Carr, I'm going to have to ask you guys to leave because we're not going to have anything to do with this kind of, I think the word was crap. I don't know, but so, and he says, I want you to know if you guys put them up, we'll make sure we shoot them down. That was his exact words.
Yeah.
If you put them up, we'll shoot you down. So that was the end of that. We more to it, but nothing extraordinary. We went back and Carr said, well, you know, now the lid, our cover's been blown. And we're going to have visitors soon. So we're going to have to make a demonstration of our adventures. And the best thing is take our 45-foot craft and I have to somewhere inject the difference between conventional thinking and etheric thinking. Because the difference is hard to put into words. When you understand who and what you are, you are energy. You're not really a body. You think you are, and so you create a life of form, which we're experiencing, but you're all creating that instantaneously. That's not who you are. That's who you think you are. The difference between who you think you are and really are is the difference. And who you really are is an unlimited, multidimensional being that goes on and on and on forever. There is no death, per se, in that consciousness, because you live forever. And I had to make that distinction here because where was I? I was talking about General Motors and then beyond. Oh, and yeah, he said, we're going to have to make a demonstration.
Yes, but it's also about consciousness compared to data.
Yes, thank you. And so to know who you are is the key to being able to operate with unlimited powers of creation and observation and everything. You can do anything because you have all the universe and multiverse working with you, not against you. You don't have to use force, you just have to use acceptance. And it flows in, these ideas will come. Yeah. In fact, it's another story that Marcia's been manifesting so much. She wanted a suitcase one day and six of them showed up instantly. I wanted to try a regular razor, but I wanted to try an electric razor. And I said, God, I'd be nice to them. And six of them showed up the next day. The people just gave them to me. I mean, you got to watch very carefully and be very careful because, boy, nature wants to give you everything. So he says, I want to get the 45.
What? It's because you're so in love. You're so full of love that you're just like oozing love couple. So that's why everything's manifesting. If I wanted a razor, I'd probably have to go off the mountain down to a store and buy one this week. But, you know, magnetism is pretty amazing.
You're doing it. You just have to acknowledge it.
And everybody doesn't have to go from A to B because they're already there. They just don't realize it. Realize where the key is. Once they realize who they are, then they say, well, I can do that. And the word can comes out instead of can't. Can't is an antiquated word. It goes away and never comes back because it's not needed. The same as Marcia and I have changed our no longer breakfast, lunch, and dinner. We have mealtime. Whenever we're hungry, we eat. When we're not hungry, we can go for days sometimes. It's just a matter.
Well, we were leading up to you stepping over all of these obstacles and inviting the press and the head of GM to your "This is how we roll" party. So let's go to that day.
Okay. Who did you invite? So Carr said, we're going to load up the 45-footer. It's operational. and we had a few test flights with it around the.
Can you scoot over so you're?
Oh, I'm sorry.
Yeah.
And thank you, Marcia.
So the car said, we're gonna bells and whistle time. We're gonna go over every city. We can go from New. We can go from. We'll start in L.A. and we're gonna go from L.A. to Chicago to New York. And the time distance, and this is why I brought up the difference between etheric thinking, being, and data thinking. Yeah. Because we had the realization at that point that we're already everywhere. All of us are already everywhere. We just don't realize it. Energy is everywhere. It can't be created or destroyed, which we learned in kindergarten, but it also is everywhere. And when you synergize with everywhere, you are everywhere. It's just a matter of projection and perception that makes the difference. The same way I traveled to Hawaii and back, and that's another story, but it was by teleporting. So what we were experiencing, he said, we're going to have to take these all over these different places, and it would take a matter of days to hit almost every state in the union, because we were already there. Well, it just had to, it's called resonance. It has to resonate with Chicago at a certain equilateral situation where you're already there and you zero into what's called zero point. And once you're there, you're there. And we're gonna make lots of sighting, lots of bells and whistles, to get people to go to the representatives and say, what the hell is this? You guys are telling us this can't happen, and there it is. That's what we wanted. So we got it ready, and he said, we're gonna have to kind of hustle, because they're on to us now, and they're gonna do the same thing they did in Oklahoma and New York and all those places. So I want you, Ralph, and I felt quite humbly honored, and two engineers, to get on board the craft, and we're going to take it downrange and come back. And when we do this a few times, then you guys will be ready to take it everywhere or anywhere that it wants to go. And we put that into control of the universe, because we were no longer in control. The universe was in control of all of this. So we got ready, suited up, got on board the craft. They closed the craft. We were inside, and we sat down. There's three of us, and in the center of the craft there was a crystal, faceted crystal ball, and a car had advised us, do not think. Keep thought out of the way. No thinking allowed. He didn't say that, but don't think. Just be who you are and focus on where you're going. We're going to go downrange and come back for an experiment. And all you have to do is focus on that, because I want your energy to resonate with that feeling. It's going to go anyway, but for you to be aware of it, you have to focus on it. It's okay. So we sat down, and this beautiful crystal was illuminated with a laser. That's, for lack of a better word, I don't know, it was a brilliant light coming up from the bottom, white light, into the crystal. And through the prisms, it lit up into billions of colors. Red could have went for years, and yellow and orange and blue all the way around. And he says, we're going down range. The engineers went down day before yesterday, 10 miles, and they measured the field that we want to take the craft to, and it was resonating in the light spectrum of the color aquamarine. Light is color, and color is light. And and when it's resonating, it creates its own force field, its own frequency. And that frequency at this point was aquamarine. So I said, that's simple. What we're going to do, we're going to get you guys on board, we're going to fire up this crystal, and we're going to let it pulsate until it feels comfortable into the area of aquamarine. Then you're starting to resonate 10 miles with the land that you're going to. And once you reach that resonant frequency, we're going to go down there and come back. It's that simple. We said, okay, that sounds great. Man, I can't wait. So we sat down and I did. I didn't think of anything. I was trying to meditate, just trying to, and focus on this crystal. And that's all I did. And then the next thing I remember at that time, because I remembered later more things, but at that time was Carr saying, okay, that's it, boys, come on down for debriefing. And we looked at one another and said, whoa, it must not have worked. We're going to have to do some more work on this. And so we went down for debriefing, and he said, well, how was it? And we said, oh, didn't work, did it? What was wrong? What happened? He said, what makes you think it didn't work? Well, I know. I was sitting here. I know darn well it didn't work myself. We didn't go anywhere. He says, okay, empty your pockets. And out of our pockets came sticks and stones and grass and everything that we picked up. We didn't know this at the time, but we were putting this on. He says, well, if you didn't go anywhere, and you were in your jumpsuits and you showered up and got on board, where did that come from? Well, we don't know. He said, well, your mind knows, but your brain, now this is where we separate the synthetic from the authenticity. Your brain is only a computer that operates your human vessel. This is a form with magnetic energy holding together your conception of form. And the brain's total operation is to control that, take care of it. That's all it's interested in. It's not interested in spaceships or submarines or anything else. So it's going to defy you, it's going to reject you, it's going to say everything outside of itself is phony, it doesn't exist. So it may take you a while to realize, because you're going to have to educate your brain to the point of realizing there's more to you and me than you think. And if you want to grow with me and we can progress on to a greater awareness of who and what you are, that'll be fine. But if you're not, you're going to have to stay where you are, because we're moving on. So in effect, what that meant was that the mind controls the experiment. The mind is who and what we are. We are collective consciousness that exists everywhere, anytime, any place. And when you know that and you synergize with that, you become one with it, and you just go with wherever nature's leading you. And later on, it took me a while to realize, now I'm almost fully, I'm fully conscious of the trip. And I down, remember, we went down, there was a little magnetic ramp too. We didn't have stairs, conventional stairs. We just had a magnetic ramp that went down. We got down and picked up all these things, put them in our pockets and came back. In my estimate, we're there about 15 minutes. Back at base, back at the plant, we were gone like 5 seconds. I mean, that was the time on their register. The craft raised up and disappeared in front of them, and then 5 seconds later or whatever came back. So there was two different time zones. And Carl said, no, there is no such thing as time. In the third dimension, yes, you measure things with time. It's a conventional way of linear projections of things. Time and space only exist if you create them. If you experience them, or if you want them to be, they will. But you are not tied into time. Nothing controls you. You are the controller of your perceptions and your life and everything. So when where you went was outside of time and space, and that's why your time seemed different than our time. And this you'll remember as time goes on and realize that teleportation is just a matter of not accepting anything out of its place, that everything in frames of reference has its place. And it's what has been difficult in this system. We place them off key, that things don't fall into their general place where they belong. They try to fit a square hole into a round peg or something like that.
Peg into square.
So you got the ship with two of the Tesla proteges to dissipate in front of the media and a couple of important people from GM. Was it all the major media was there, or just local players? Who was there watching this happen?
General Motors wasn't there. They didn't want any part of us.
Oh.
They weren't there. The coverage we had was all of our own entourage, our own outfit. We didn't have a media coverage at that time. Although we found out later that we were being monitored by the same people that put on the radio show Galaxy. Those were our benevolent friends. They had monitored the entire thing. And later on, in different states of consciousness, we would converse on a different level of consciousness with those beings and said, yeah, you did well, it's good. Now keep going. And so we knew we were where we needed to be, and we felt very, very good about it. There was the actual experiment was copied on an 8mm film, and there was a copy of it, but it's gotten lost through the years. I don't know what happened to it, but it showed the craft going up and disappearing and coming back. And it got lost in Carr's archive somewhere, because a little later, we had visitors, as Carr expected. These visitors came in 2 10-by trucks, loaded with soldiers with guns, and black cars with badges of FBI, whatever they were, CIA or whatever. And they gathered us all together, and they said they want to talk to Carr. And they said, we're telling you to cease and desist at this point. We are confiscating everything. And Carr said, well, we're just hobbyists. We're just experimenting here. We're not harming anything. Well, you are attempting to overthrow the monetary system in the United States, and that can be held as treason, high treason, and we can do anything we want to with you guys. But right now, we're gonna haul all this stuff away, tell you to disappear and never come back together, and don't talk to each other, don't even think about talking to each other, because we'll be watching you the rest of your lives. So, in essence, that was what happened.
And what has happened since?
Oh, okay.
Tell about where the craft has been spotted.
Oh.
What is safe to talk about only?
Yes.
What?
What's safe to talk about only?
Oh, yeah. Oh, it's all safe.
No addresses, no names.
Yeah.
No countries.
Everything's safe to us now because we are a part of everything and everybody, and they don't dare touch us without realizing they're touching themselves. So we are comfortable talking about these things that we've been allowed to talk about all these years, and put in the quack department. So they figure, well, that's safe. They're in the quack department. Just don't worry about them. But what did you say?
Oh, I tell her what you have heard about this.
I was
OTCX1.
I eventually retired out of the whole thing. Long story short, went to Prescott, Arizona, and bought 12 acres of land and wanted to build spaceships. I wanted to start another thing. I knew I had to be isolated, and it was way out, it was 18 miles out of town. And that's where Marcia and I met. That was 1981 or two or something like that.
1980.
And I proceeded to build an underground house, built on the same principles, the same geometric, sacred geometry that we used in the craft. And I had to use, we were on a crystal outcropping. We had tourmaline, we had quartz crystal, and we had to, every 4 feet in the building of the craft, of the house, we had to put these crystals. And it's on, it's also on the website. There's pictures of it. A guy did get it. 8mm and took pictures of us building the building the house and how it was built and everything. So if anybody wants to see it, it's there. But that's when I met Marcia. And where was I going with that? I get these memory lapses.
Well, I'm talking about where you are now with this work and if the ships are still being produced.
I want you to tell them when you did the lecture at the college.
Oh, that's it. Well, they thought it was extraordinary that my wife and I, which Marcia married us on that land before I even dug the hole. Marcia married my mate and I, and we built this extraordinary underground house. It's still there to this day, and anybody that wants to see it can go through us because the present owner has invited us forever to come and show people the house. And it's been remodified because it had to come up to conventional code. So it's not the same as we built it, but anyway.
It's close.
It's close. So I was asked to go speak at Yavapai College about how in the world could you build this thing with nothing? You guys say you build it out of scraps and garage sales and
the home, the underground house.
Yeah, I built a house that was estimated to be almost $200,000 for $5,000 and complete. I mean, up to that point. It hadn't been completed, but to that point. Can you come in and tell us about it? So I went into the college, and that's on film. It's on film and on the archives. So I told them, yeah, man, there's nothing to it. You use your intuition to guide you. And, oh, there's a garage sale over there, and they got one of those. Okay. Or you just follow in your feelings. Don't try to outthink yourself because you won't go anywhere. So I collected all these ways of developing ideas and techniques and material and started building the underground house. And while I was at Yavapai College, the Freedom of Information Act had come into effect. And a professor had come from somewhere and was talking at Yavapai College on the Freedom of Information. He says, well, I just got back from Los Alamos, New Mexico. And he says, it was extraordinary. They took me, I was allowed to go underground, and I saw many, many things that they don't even know about up here that are working and stuff. And he said, in this one big hangar, I saw this 45-foot, and I said, wait a minute, 45-foot craft called the OTCX-1. That wasn't labeled then, but it is now. And I got acquainted with one of the guards that told me they'd been trying to mount weapons on the craft because they wanted to make scout ships out of them so they could use these fast-moving machines in war and combat and stuff. And he said they kept blowing themselves up. And I said, well, yeah, I didn't talk to the professor then, but I said, well, of course, because in magnetic fields, weapons are obsolete. You don't need weapons. You don't have to have weapons. And so he said, well, I saw the craft and I talked to them. They said that they gave up trying to put weapons on them because they were having a lot of difficulties with them, but it was still there 9 floors underground at Los Alamos, New Mexico. And
that's what I went to see.
Yeah. And even if they got it to work, they could never get the thing fired up because you have to use love. And love is the only thing that would work on it. You had to love what you're doing, love the machine. You had to synergize with the machine. Because the machine, that's all we are, is a machine. So it's one machine to another, and you synergize with that on a resonant frequency. You communicate, and you can feel the level of acceptance and non-acceptance, and you know where to go because you're guided away from the things that are not necessary or not adequate.
Many years later, all of these stories and everything were great, and I saw as the time went on, more and more people have accepted Ralph, and now there's no question. Everybody seems to believe him.
Not everybody,
but a lot. But one of the things that really kind of put it together was watching David Adair's movie. I don't know if that's on our website.
That's on our website as well. His name is David Adair, and as a young man, he created a rocket that was almost faster than the speed of light, David Adair. And he was contacted by the government to make a better rocket to fly it to Area 51. And this is all if you can't find it, we've got discs, and in fact, I think it's even for sale on one of the.
I don't know.
Anyway, long story short, he went to Patterson Air Force Base and set up a demonstration and flew this rocket all the way to Area 51, and proved that it was faster than anything, and so. They flew him to Area 51 and said, well, now tell us more about your rocket here and how it works and everything. But he got there, and instead of going to the rocket, they took him over to an area called S4 something in Area 51. It was underground hangars, and he went in with them. And they went down like maybe 20 stories. I don't know. He said it was enormous. But he got to this level where they guided him into a room where there was a recovered spaceship. Parts of a spaceship had been crashed. And they said, we want you to look at this thing and tell us how it operates. He said, wait a minute. Why do you want me to tell you how to operate your craft? It's just look at it and tell, because he was 17 years old at this time.
And this was, this like motor, whatever it is, was like the size of a bus. It was huge.
And so he got on, he understood because of his rocket, his knowledge of was etheric in nature. I mean, he knew how things really work, not how you think they work. And he got up on the craft, and this is all on the tape. They showed a replica demonstration
the movie.
Yeah, kind of a movie. And he touches the craft, and his fingers glow, and the craft was talking to him through his fingers. You could see the energy synergized. And he says, oh, this is a symbiotic craft here. This is wonderful. They just keep going, and they kept pushing him. Go inside and see how this thing works. And he went in and explained it. He says, this is even beyond what I've seen, but this thing is operating on things 500 years ahead of us. I mean, it is real, and it works. And he says, but why are you asking me? And they said, just shut up and tell us what you can find out. He said, well, I can't tell you much about it right
now. He realized they were
enemy.
Enemy. Yes. They realized they were.
Yeah.
And he shut up. He says, no, you better take me to my rocket right now. There's a time delay on it, and I have to check it. So they rushed him out to his rocket, but on the way out, he got some hangar grease, that the rollers on the hangar or something, got some grease, and grease and electronics don't mix. They create a chemical reaction that's very dangerous. So he went over to his rocket, and he realized they were the enemy, And he said, well, I can't let them have this because they're going to use it for destructive things. And my whole intent is to use it for constructive things. So he went over and popped the lid up and put the grease up where it would be the most effective on the craft, closed the lid. And he said, better get out of here, boys. I think it's going to blow. And this is all on the tape. They can see. And he's wording it himself. And they went out away from it and it blew up. And he said, that's the end of that. Well, the government wouldn't let him go. And they said, I'll tell you what, we'll put you to work. He's in the aircraft designing industry now. And we'll give you everything you need for the rest of your life and take good care of you and everything. But don't ever try to build any more of these or don't talk about it. Don't do anything. And that's on the tape. That's what you want me to do.
Yeah.
David Adair. Well,
only because of time. I know that we need to wrap up shortly, but this has been such remarkable information, which is guiding us in the direction of knowing that there's nothing more important than our consciousness.
Yes.
And working with the plasmic field to connect science, consciousness, and the heart. Yes. And again, I think it's why a lot of the women are being expelled from having a voice. It's why the brilliant people such as yourself and the rocket inventor are being expelled, because if they can't use it to blow up and destroy things, but again, what were people such as yourself and the rocket inventor are being expelled because if they can't use it to blow up and destroy things, but again, what we're saying now is the old paradigm.
Yes.
So here we are. It is March 15th. And what if, I always end the shows with, what if it's true that we are in the Grand Jubilee any minute? That all of a sudden, the whole frequency, the whole density is rising and nobody can stop it.
Nobody.
Then...
I accept that.
The only thing that I heard that I really loved that I will take forever, when I said to Nassim Haramein, what do you know that I don't know? Give me a jewel. He said, every single person has a spaceship.
Yeah.
Now I understand what he was talking about. It's up to us to raise our frequency to be able to step into it, release all of our texting ideas and criminal corruption ideas, and put the phone down and get into the ship, stare at the crystal, blank out, and perhaps go somewhere important.
Yes.
And the whole whole idea of the spaceship was to raise the well, they were symbiotic in themselves, because you raise the consciousness, you raise the idea of a spaceship, and then you've raised the consciousness within yourself where you don't even need a spaceship because you use what's called a Merkaba, which is your energy field. And you can, and we're doing all these things right now, but don't realize them. And that's what we want to do, is realize who they are and start using these techniques and ideas themselves. But some people like Maseratis and Corvettes, and some people like spaceships, and fine, I want one. So we keep pounding away at it. And I thank you very much for this opportunity, both you and Mr. Weber.
Well, I thank you for your dedication. And again, I think it is dedication that's going to get us to the other side, because I wouldn't wish the pummeling I received last year from these hackers on anyone other than to hold up the mirror and hand it back to them and their puppet masters. But you know, for us, it's about leaving all that behind. I just keep saying leaving it behind, because it is the only way to raise our frequency. They can't see us. And it is gonna be the only way to save this beautiful mother, this beautiful planet, is to, like you said, raise the frequency. Interesting how you just said we won't even need ships. It's like, boy, that is another level up, isn't it? So I do want to invite people to my website also, which I had to build a new website because the last one was killed. It's cropcirclefilms.com. And if you want to tell us your website again, and Alfred his, although he sat there so quiet the whole show, probably in some amazement.
I just blabbed away. I wanted to get enough in So it'd be interesting, you know. And the other thing I want to add is we've got hundreds of pods, because Blue Star Enterprise has created a network of pods. Or when I was in Hawaii, and the resident project is where I also came out of with Nisam, and he was going a science way and I was going a natural way, but I became a part of the Elders of the Round Table, and that's a long story, but where was I going with this? Oh, pods. So we used to swim with the dolphins every morning, so they were in pods, and I said, well, what are you going to call these engineers and kids and elderly people working on these little devices in their garages and everything? Groups of people? Well, let's call them pods. So that's how the name pods became known. And now on our website and on our Skype, you can catch me on Skype or Blue Star Enterprise on Skype. Expanded out now where there's thousands and thousands of people working on alternative ideas. I was in one engineer's laboratory. I saw five magnetic motors running for weeks and weeks without ever stopping. Cold, I could put my hand on them, there wasn't any heat. And these devices are ready when the public raises the consciousness and say, no more of this crap, I want that. Then we can open our doors, and all these pods with all their wonderful devices will stream into life and make life very, very pleasant for people. Is that okay?
That's
the best. I love you. Wonderful. Thank you so much. Thank you both so much for having us on. Yeah.
Yeah.
Alfred, what'd you feel?
Well, this is for me opened up just a whole new vista, because for me it just feeds into the work that we've been doing over the last little while and what I call the ascension hypothesis. And that is that the Earth itself is going through a planetary ascension, quote, or a density shift. And what we were able to put forth in this hypothesis, which we delivered at a conference in Poland last October, is that it's cyclical. It's we're inside of our universe now, and it turns out that according to this approach, universes are really machines for soul development. That you can look at them that way. I kind of look at a universe as a washing machine for souls. And it's got a wash cycle, a rinse cycle, and a spin cycle. And those are the three types of yugas, each one of which is like 25,920 years long. And we're in the spin cycle now, which is, some people call it the Kali Yuga, which is kind of the most rigorous of the soul development cycles. So much synthesis came together in your talk. I wouldn't call it a talk as much as you transported us into what is. That I am in utter awe. And this has not been an interview, it's been a voyage. And so that's why I said, it's not let's get to the spaceship, it's we're in the spaceship. And so that's kind of my comment.
Thank you, sir, very, very much. That means everything to us. Thank you. It tells us that we're living up to what we want to be, and that's just to be a part of everything and everyone, and to continue to enlighten people to do the same thing and enjoy the change, because it's coming daily now. There's changes everywhere.
And it's all from truth. Yeah. Everything needs to be from truth. And And what we speak is from our truth. And I know what you're speaking is from your truth. It's so it's such a blessing to meet you.
Yes.
And to thank you so much for having us with you. And Patty, thank you so much. You're such a special person.
I might explain for the audience sake that I have adopted using metaphors because they're much more efficient than word power. Word power goes so far, and you can't possibly remember 50 years ago what color of shoes you had or what color, what was the atmosphere, what was the temperature. But metaphorically, I can paint a picture around, it was a pleasant day and I had clothes on, and that covers it. Then you go on to the point in question and get from point to point to point without all the details. They're not necessary. So I use metaphors to put things together. I want to thank you.
I think when I go into my brain, I don't remember dates and addresses, but I remember the essence and the feeling. And that again, taking us into that higher conscious mind of intuition rather than data. Yes. So I want to wish the entire world a whole lot more intuition, telepathy, consciousness, and stop bragging and walking toward that sinkhole because we're not buying it. Be real and get on the ship with us.
I love you, Patty, and I love you, Alfred. Thank you so much.
Thank you.